Hello, everyone. Welcome to Community Keynotes. My name is Melissa Majors, and I'm so blessed to be the creator of the show. And normally, I open each episode with my co-producer, Amani Roberts, but not today. Amani is backstage preparing a very special experience for us. Now, let me tell you about my friend Amani. He is a leader that I truly look up to and admire, not because he's my friend, but because he's earned it. He has lived a life that's full of twists and turns and ups and downs and adventures and risks, heartache and heartbreak. And he's going to share his life story with us today on the show. But given that Amani has dedicated his life to music, it's only fitting that he tell his story and play the songs that accompanied those incredible memories. And so without further ado, viewers, help me welcome to the Community Keynote stage, Amani Roberts.
Thank you very much, Melissa. So my name is Amani Roberts. I'm a professional DJ, among other things. And one of my favorite things about DJing is just how you can play a certain song and you can see the reaction from people in the audience and how they get taken back to a time when either they first heard the song or when the song had significance for them. And so during this journey today, I'm going to share with you many songs that have had an impact on my life. I'm going to try to describe as best as I can the memories that come up with what songs they are. And then I'm going to explain to you what lessons I learned from each song. So, you know, feel free to engage in the chat. Let me know what you think. I'm going to ask you some questions. And the first question I'm going to ask you is that, what is your strongest memory from your childhood?
When I think about your loving, the sunny evenings, the fun we used to share.
So this song right here, this is George Duke, Sweet Baby, and I kind of describe to you what I think of when I hear this song. Maybe I was like 7 or 8 years old. I used to share a bedroom with my brother. I'd wake up to the smell of like eggs, bacon, pancakes, and my dad would play this song on the stereo to wake us up, really. But, you know, he loved the song also. And, you know, the lesson here is pretty simple. Just appreciate your youth and the simple times. I didn't really realize then how simple I had it. The only thing I had to worry about was doing my homework, getting ready for my MSI select soccer game, making sure my uniform was clean. That was it. It's so simple compared to now when we have so many other things to worry about. So I think about this song, and I just think about that as well. And it's just like the simple times of our youth. I think they say youth is wasted on the young, which is very true. So the next song I'm going to play for you brings me back to, let's say, fifth grade or fourth grade. Let's say Woodland Elementary School, a packed cafeteria. We had the talent show and, you know, there are people standing against the walls. The previous year, I had played this talent show and I had played the flute and did horrible. I was scared to come back again because my flute malfunctioned. I never touched the flute again. I then began to play the saxophone. And so one of my favorite artists was Whitney Houston. You can see right up here. This is the album where I played the song from. It's called All at Once. I'm going to play it for you really quickly.
All at once, I finally took a moment and I'm realizing that you're not coming back.
So this song really brings me back to the lesson that I learned in terms of be open to opportunities that scare you and make you nervous. Now, this lesson is going to come back again a little later, but it's another really simple lesson I learned really young. You know, something scares you, either if it's a new job, trying a new skill, maybe you meet a new person and they scare you as well. You know, don't run away from it. You know, maybe lean into that, try that again. So that's what that song brings me back to. Ironically, even though I was quite scared, I actually did really well in the talent show and got second place. So that was cool. That taught me early on that once you're scared, if you lean into it, good things could happen as well. So next up, I want you to picture, or my question for you really is that I always love to ask people this. did you love high school more or after high school, college? What did you love more? For me, based on what I went through in high school, college, I kind of loved high school more. I was able to meet some of my closest friends in life there. So I want to play this song that reminds me of high school.
Been stabbed in the back by someone you thought was really cool.
All right, so that's Jody Wiley, Rakim, Friends. And so this one really, okay, so high school, like I want you to picture, for me, once a really big high school, I used to walk to high school before I had a car, walk like a mile to high school, uphill both ways. No, just kidding. But anyways, you walk in and like there's a student parking lot where we all kind of meet up and gather, and it's just really crowded, cars everywhere, music blasting from people's stereos. And, you know, you just kind of go there. That's where you meet up before class. At lunchtime, we had open lunch, so we'd go out to lunch. And then after school. And in high school, as I said, I met some of my closest friends in life. But I also learned, like, definitely choose your friends wisely. I made some bad decisions in terms of friends that I chose to do that maybe didn't go to class, you know, or getting into drugs and stuff like that. But also, I learned early on that you're the sum of the five people you spend the most time with. Now, even in this kind of virtual age, it's still true because, you know, the people you spend the most time with on FaceTime, emailing, chatting with, you know, you still talk to them so much, you become the sum of the five people you spend the most time with. And also, just choose your friends wisely because they're a reflection on who you are. So that's it. Next up, after I finished high school, I went to college. I want to ask you, as you've been living in life, have you ever tried to be something that you just really were not? And so I want to ask you that question. I'm going to play you a couple hits that really bring me back to college. I went to Howard University. I'm going to kind of paint the picture for you after I drop this song.
Have you ever met a girl that you tried to date, but a year to make love, she wanted you to wait? Let me tell you a story of my situation.
All right, so the first track there was Hypnotize, Biggie Smalls, and then Just a Friend, Biz Markie. I went to Howard University. Howard University's homecoming is internationally known. It's an amazing time. I want you to imagine you walk through kind of like a small little kind of walkway. You pass by like, you know, the Performing Arts Center. You pass by the football field, Green Stadium. You're walking up. Ahead of you is this building we call Blackburn Center. That's where you would go to eat your meals. And then you turn to the right. And the far right, far ahead is the library. And that's where they would set up the stage for homecoming when artists would come in. And this is where I saw Biggie Smalls perform at homecoming. You're walking, as you get closer, the music gets louder and louder. Of course, the crowd gets thicker and thicker as well. And you just hear him performing. And so in college, you know, we learn a lot in college. And in college, when I was going there, the kind of the end thing was to be like mean and hard and tough and rugged. And as hard as I tried, you know, I'm just like, you know, I'm a lover, not a fighter. And so it just wouldn't work. And it took me like maybe 3 years and one semester to figure that out. You know, instead of maybe going to like, you know, a crazy party in the basement of someone's house, I wanted to go to the movies and check out the latest rom-com that came out or whatever. I mean, I love to go to parties too, don't get me wrong. But that was just kind of how I was in Howard and college. And it just really taught me to just trust who you are, keep moving forward, and don't try to change to fit into a trend. The second most valuable lesson I learned at Howard is that when people show you who you are, believe them, because you meet people, you think they might be out for your best interest. They show you that they're not. They may be selfish. It could be like, you know, getting a grade change. It could be like maybe stealing a job opportunity that you had. Maybe even you like a young lady in my case and they go after them on intentionally and try to foil that. Just when people show you who they are, believe them. And that's a lesson that I've learned throughout my entire life. And it's just so valuable. And it took me many, many years after college to really believe that. But now I'm doing pretty well at practicing that. When I was in college, and I'm going to change. About 6 months before I graduated, I had no idea that I was going to live outside of Washington, D.C. Grew up in the D.C. area. My perspective was that, oh, I'm just going to end up working here. I'm never, ever going to leave, until one of my good friends said, you know, maybe you should think about leaving, and you can always come back. Home is home, but going to another city to live. So I'll put this song on.
I wanna see you. I wanna meet you. I wanna show you, man, that I need you. I want your body.
All right, so Key Sweat, Athena Cage, Nobody, back to like 1996. Where were you when you were watching the 96 Olympics? It was in the United States. It was in Atlanta. I got a job opportunity to work the Olympics for Marriott. I'd already been working for Marriott since I was 17 years old. And the lesson here is that take a risk. I was scared to move away, no doubt. I didn't know, but maybe two or three people in Atlanta. I had my aunt there, which helped. And just say yes. You know, I said yes. I went down there. I'm going to try to paint the picture of the building I was working in. I worked in the basement of this building. During the Olympics, you would walk around the whole city and you see all these different like little vendors with like their shop, their little cart selling you ice cream, soda, Gatorade, snacks, chips. And so all around the Atlanta Market Center, which was one right across the street from Centennial Olympic Park, where the bombing happened there, I had two colleagues that were hurt that were at the concert during the bombing. One of them lost two fingers. It's crazy. And so what happens is that people at the different venues would pay in cash, because credit cards were only popular then. They bring back the cash to me in this basement. I would be counting the money. I had a safe there that I had to balance that was like $250,000. I had to count up every night to make sure it was at $250,000 and 0 cents. It couldn't be over by a quarter or behind by a quarter. It was crazy. But I had a little small, I wish I had one to show you, but I had a little small transistor radio. And, you know, this song was really popular at the time. And so, you know, just put it on and everything. So that's what I think about. The lesson there is just take risks and say yes. We're going to keep moving. And now, put this one on. All right, so that's Celia Cruz, La Vida Es Un Carnaval. I moved to Chicago. I continued to work for Marriott. I was managing, front desk, restaurant, and sales. But, you know, it's a small executive team at the hotel there. And I worked a lot with the housekeepers. And so at lunchtime, the housekeepers would, would help me. They would teach me. I was still pretty fluent in Spanish, but they would talk in Spanish. I would learn. I would ask questions. Then they would ask me questions about learning English. And so I'll ask you, have you ever had a boss that treated you the same way that they treated their boss? Because when you do that, when you treat people as equals, they respect you more, they're more loyal, and they just really will open up and show you things and things about themselves that they might not normally say. And I have to say that that's why I played the salsa song there, because they taught me about dancing a salsa. They taught me about the Latin American culture, the food, what it means to eat together as a family and why it's so important to them. And so the lesson here is just, you know, treat everyone with respect no matter what position they are, whether or not they're two positions ahead of you or two positions, quote unquote, underneath you. Just treat people with respect, because you never know when you meet them again. And the true sign of this is that when I left that hotel, usually just your department will come by for your going away party. But at this hotel, every single department came, and the housekeepers came. Even the ones that were off work came as well. So that was really, you know, shows you kind of what happened there as well. Next song.
Wanna be a baller, shot caller, 20 in play, only in parlor, caller, get late tonight. Switch and roll tight, got spray, but I ain't not hit the highway. Fly away, but it's got to be a bad way.
So this song brings me to Dallas, Texas, where our lovely co-host and creator Melissa lives currently. And I went to Dallas, Texas. I had a really big job. I was general manager of a hotel at age 23 and met a young lady. She was also living there. I thought it was meant to be. The question I would ask you is, for me, did you grow up watching John Hughes movies, 16 Candles, Pretty in Pink, and think that was real life? Maybe I was a little bit naive and thought that that was real life. So I go to Dallas, Texas, and I moved there, and I had a really, really good experience working, did great in the job. But, you know, life kind of didn't turn out the way I thought it would be. I thought that maybe, you know, this was it. You get married, 2.5 kids, a dog, white picket fence, but it didn't go well. So the lesson learned here was just that, you know, life is not a fairy tale with unicorns and rainbows. Like, you're going to have some good times, but you're going to have some bad times. So it's really important that you learn how to get through the bad times, because usually good times are right after that. And it just was rough personally for me, but that was a valuable lesson. That song brings me back to that time period, driving up and down Walnut Hill Road in Dallas, Texas, trying to get to work, back home work. That's a really simple lesson there, but it's important to share. Now, next.
Here I am in the place where I come let go. In Miami, the base and the sunset low. Every day like a Mardi Gras. Everybody party all day. No work, all play, okay? So we sip a little something, lay the rest to spill. Me and Charlie at the bar running up a hot bill.
All right, so Miami. Once again, I moved to Miami. This time, I went from being a general manager of a hotel, big job, to being a sales manager in a regular hotel. So I ask you, have you ever had to take a step back to pursue something greater? And in Dallas, I fell in love with sales. I love the sales process. I love working in sales. But in order for me to move forward, I had to take a step back. So the lesson here is real quick and simple. Have you ever, you know, it's sometimes you need to take a step back to move forward. And that's what I did in Miami. It changed my life because I really did well in sales. And, you know, people were like, why are you going to go from a general manager to a sales manager? But you just have to be committed, stay strong, and go from there. And that was a quick lesson I learned there, and I'm forever grateful. Now, I want you to think, grew up in D.C., I left, I moved to all these cities, then I moved back. I moved back to D.C. August 20th, 2001. And so I want to ask you, before I play this song, you can think about it. Is there someone that you've lost that you wish you could spend some more time with and talk to currently?
If I told you once, I told you twice. You can see it in my eyes. I'm all cried out with nothing to say. You're everything I wanted to be.
So Keisha Cole with Diddy last night. As I said, I moved back to D.C. August 20th, 2001. I worked at the Crystal Gateway Marriott. We were four blocks from the Pentagon. September 11th happened. I was in the hotel when that happened. People were fleeing the Pentagon, coming to our hotel. Smoke from the plane crashing into the Pentagon was coming into our hotel. And the one thing that still is very haunting is that there was no cell phone service because the towers were just all messed up. People were coming in asking us to use our email to send emails to their loved ones to let them know they were safe. I'll never forget that. And people were just sending emails from our email accounts. It was crazy. I'd never seen that before. And then you fast forward 3 years, I lost my dad suddenly. He had a heart attack in his sleep and died suddenly. And that was kind of what really, I hope I pronounced this word right, but it kind of took my naivete. I hope I said that right. Let me know, Melissa. I hope I said that right. But it took my naivete away and just really said that it's very cliche, but it's appropriate. Like, tomorrow's not guaranteed, so you definitely have to take advantage of the time you have to give people their roses while they're here. That's the lesson here, is to, you know, give people their roses, celebrate them while they're here. Don't wait until they leave to celebrate them. Take the time to celebrate them now, because you never know what will happen tomorrow, both with what happened with September 11th and what will happen with my dad. And that's the lesson there as well.
Come here, mirror. Mirror. Love.
All right, so Rick James, Mary Jane. It's not what you're thinking it is. Although, you know, when I first shared this story with some people, they thought something else. But anyways, I moved to L.A. In 2007. I then took many, many risks here. So the lessons that I learned both moving to Atlanta as well as when I was playing at Whitney Houston All at Once really came to a head here. I took two major risks moving to Atlanta, moving to LA. First one was I decided to leave my full-time, well-going, well-achieved career with Marriott and pursue DJing full-time. I did that. Part of my way to getting up to speed with being a DJ was attend Scratch Academy. I attended Scratch Academy. I'm used to being an overachiever, you know, all-state soccer player, general manager 23, like I'm used to being good. And I got there and I took my test and you have to get 320 out of 400 to pass. I got 318. They didn't pass me. They gave me feedback. So I learned that feedback is a gift. And this is where I really had a decision. Driving down the 405, after getting this feedback, I could decide to take the feedback and continue, or do I take my ball and just go home and forget it? So as I'm telling the story, I want you to think about, is it really hard for you to take feedback? It was very hard for me. That was one of the times where I really learned how to take better feedback. And yeah, and so I was able to come back, complete the class, get a really high score and do well. The next risk I took, and it goes back to the lesson I learned in terms of moving to Atlanta and just saying, yes, I got an opportunity that came up through networking, through MPI, Southern California, being the vice president of membership. Cal State Fullerton said they had an open teacher position. The experience that I had matched up with what they were looking for the class. I never taught in college before. I've been teaching people how to DJ and maybe at the high school, junior high school level briefly, just guest appearances. But I just said yes. And I said, let me figure it out. And I stepped into the uncomfortable. And I'm still there after 2.5 semesters. I love it. When I was growing up, I thought I want to stay as far away from what my dad had done. But he was a teacher and a professor at Howard University, chairman of the department. And it's so funny how life comes full circle, because there I am teaching. I love it. I do pretty well at it. So that's the lesson. Like, take feedback. Don't take feedback personally. But also, applying lessons from before, say yes, take risks, and just see what will happen.
Darling, I care for you more than my own self. Darling, I share with you.
So this is the final lesson. This kind of, in my opinion, is the song of quarantine 2020. It just came really popular during quarantine. I would ask you right now, are you currently scared of what's going on in the world and life? Because I am. I'm very scared. My business is going to be completely different. I'm a DJ. I travel around. There are no events happening. What's going to look like when it returns? I don't know. But I didn't allow myself to get paralyzed. I started live streaming. Melissa was gracious enough to offer me a chance to work with her on the show. And, you know, just don't be paralyzed. Take action. I know it can be scary and kind of daunting right now, but don't allow yourself to be paralyzed. That's the lesson here. Don't get paralyzed. Take action, even if it's taking one step a day. And if you take one step every day, you look up 7 days from now, you'll be 7 steps further to where you want to be. That's the lesson. I hope you enjoyed my reminiscing and the lessons I shared. I'm going to turn it back over to Melissa for the next portion of our show.
Yay, Amani Roberts, wonderful job. Thank you so much for your story, for having our heads bobbing. I enjoyed every minute of your story. Thank you so much for sharing that with us. And now, viewers, you can see why I look up to him. What an incredible Renaissance man, someone with so many talents and such a colorful and diverse life so far. I'm sure there's a much, much more ahead. Now, Amani, as every show that we have, the speaker gets to choose the charity. We do a fundraising piece for the charity of the speaker's choice. So Amani today has chosen Camp Spinoff. It's a summer camp for aspiring DJs and producers. Ages between 12 and 17, they turn their curiosities and dreams of learning how to DJ into reality during an action-packed week. And your gifts today will be used to help fund scholarships for those kids, to expand resources for teens who may not have the opportunity to attend Camp Spinoff otherwise. If we can have more Amanis in the world, people who can multitask and be flexible and learn the skill of leadership and DJing, I think we could leave this world a better place than how we found it. So it's really easy for you to give. You can text your gift to the number that you see on the screen. You could scan the QR code that you see, or you can go to givebutter.com/community-keynotes. 60% of your gift will go directly to Camp Spinoff, and then 40% will be used to fund the production of Community Keynotes. Every penny counts. So please consider sharing a gift with Camp Spinoff and Community Keynotes today. Also, Amani's story is incredibly inspiring. So there's another fun way that you can not only wear his story in your heart, you can wear it on your sleeve or across your face with the merchandise that we have created that's been inspired by Amani. So make sure you visit storystore.us to take a look at some of the really cool merchandise we have inspired by Amani's life. 10% of the proceeds from sales will also go to Camp Spinoff. And with that, I would like to invite Amani back to the stage. Amani is a master interviewer, but today he's in the interviewee seat. So I get to pepper you with questions next few minutes, my friend. Yeah, wonderful. Now, listen, you took the ultimate leap when you left a thriving career in hotel management, Amani, to become a professional DJ. What really was the catalyst behind that major career shift?
I would say two things, really. Of course, as I spoke about in 2004, when I lost my dad suddenly, that really scared me, kind of shook me up. And then, you know, honestly, I had a boss at Marriott that was more focused on her career and moving her career forward. So really wasn't worried about developing her people. And then the job was transforming into more spreadsheets and meetings and less about the people. And as you can see, I love working with people. So I said, you know, life's not guaranteed. If there's any time period where I have some savings, I can make the leap now. It just kind of made sense. So, and then also living in California is just something about creativity and pursuing like your dreams on the creative aspect that's encouraged. It's kind of in the fiber and the culture of the city. So those three were kind of a perfect combination. I said, you know, let's go for it.
That's wonderful. Well, I think you've certainly found your life's calling. I'm glad you opened your gift, Amani Roberts. Hey, so viewers, it's not such a secret that Amani is like Mariah Carey's biggest fan, the biggest fan on earth. So if she happens to be watching today, Amani, what would you tell Miss Mariah Carey?
Ooh, I would tell her, thank you for providing us with so many decades of great music. I would say if you ever need a tour DJ, you know, call me. I'll make it happen. I'd love to be your tour DJ. Or if you ever want to work on a song together, I'm an up-and-coming producer, so I'll do that. And maybe one day I could actually play on the piano the song Vanishing that she has, which is one of my favorites by her. I would love to do that as well. Those would be the three things I'd say to her right now.
All right, viewers, if anybody has a hookup and connection to Mariah Carey, please make sure that she hears that directly from Amani Roberts. So, Amani, you're a published author. Congratulations on your book, DJs Mean Business. I downloaded it the day it came out and finished reading it the day after. I loved every word. Check it out on Amazon, folks. DJs Mean Business by Amani Roberts. Now, I hear there's another book in the works, Amani. Can you tell us or give us a hint about what the next book is about?
Yes, I can. If you look at history in the music industry, there were always Black R&B groups in Billboard Top 20 from like the 1950s all the way to the early 2000s. If you look at right at the early 2000s, they kind of just fell off, no more. So we're going to look at the history, how they came to be so prominent in the Billboard charts, what has happened for them to fall off the charts, why, and then we're going to make some predictions in terms of what will the future look like. And it's just been a fascinating project with the interviews and the research that I have with my student team from Cal State Fullerton, and I really love this project. I'm very passionate about it, and I can't wait to share our findings and the interviews and our predictions. I'm just really excited about it. So thank you very much for asking. I'm in love with this project.
I can't wait either. So when can we expect the book to come out?
Let's see, if we're in November now, maybe in the next year, like fall of next year, it takes a little while for the books, but that's the goal. I just have so many other interviews to do. Let's give me 12 months and see where we are in 12 months.
Well, you want to get this one right. You don't want to rush through it.
Exactly.
So well done. Fantastic. So I'm going to give you a little taste of your own interview medicine here, Amani Roberts. What's your favorite failure? That's one of his famous questions, yes, by the way, on his podcast series. What is your favorite failure?
I would definitely go back to the story about not passing a Scratch Academy 318 out of 400, and that forcing me to choose whether or not I should move forward and continue or stop. I think that was one of, you know, top five moments in life, most important moments, because I could go either left or right, and I made that decision and I'm better for it, but that definitely comes to mind right away.
Oh, that's fantastic. Thank you so much. I only have two more questions for you. If you could go back and give 18-year-old Amani advice, what would you say?
Woo! I knew you were going to ask this. I'm so happy you did. I'm so happy. I would say a couple things. I would say be open to living internationally. Just kind of put that in your mindset. I would say DJing is a legitimate career. When I was 18, I thought it was just like a plaything. I didn't think it was real. It is a very real career. You can make a lot of money. You can be very happy, and it's legit. I would definitely say that. And the third thing I would say is, which I'm still working on, is try to avoid the comparison trap. So, you know, it can be comparing myself to other DJs. It could be comparing myself to my friends who maybe have like families with kids and these high prominent jobs where I'm still kind of like an entrepreneur, like grinding away single. So don't compare. And then comparing myself to other like producers and things, just try to avoid the comparison trap as long as possible, because really I can't compare my chapter 3 to someone else's chapter 26. Mm. And that's really good advice that I really learned late. I'm still young, but late in my current years as well.
Yeah, that's relevant advice, not only for our younger selves, but for our current selves as well. Thank you so much. Amani, viewers, you can see Amani's an incredible leader. I'm so grateful, Amani, that you shared your wisdom with us on the story today. I have one last request. Mm-hmm. Our nation needs some joy and some happiness and some healing. So if you were the DJ for all of America, I would like for you to play us a song to take us out. But while Amani is pulling that up, I want to give you a quick heads up about next week's episode, in which we feature Cass McMahon next Monday, December 7th at 12 Central. Cass has an incredible story of how she has lived and managed a hidden illness. She has some incredible tips for all of us on how to take control and manage our best healthy lives. And so make sure you tune in next Monday for Cass McMahon. And with that, Amani, I'll turn it back over to you to take us home, my friend.